Very good day, everybody. We are into week 5 of discussing essays and ethics. Today's topic has been picked up from 2019. It's a topic on society, GS paper 1. The topic, I'll read it out, is South Asian societies are woven not around the state, but around their plural cultures and plural identities. Let me repeat. South Asian societies are woven not around the state, but around their plural cultures and plural identities. Let's try to understand the meaning. What does it mean? It means that the state, the identity of a state, is either superimposed later because our cultures and identities are multiple and go way back into the historical past, and that they tend to have more importance than the identity created by the state. Our societal identities are individual identities. Let's pick up a few meanings of certain terms. Now, the essay topic talks about a state. The state is a political concept. It's a nation or territory considered as an organized political community under one government. But strictly going by the definition of political theory, a state is purely political. It has to have four features for something to be called a state. It must have a territory. It must have a population. It must have a government. And it must be sovereign. I repeat, a state is a political concept. It has four features going strictly by the political science, political theory definition. It must have a territory, a population, a government, and sovereignty. A nation is different. A nation is a cultural concept where culture is a way of life. A nation is a large body of people united by common descent, history, culture, or language, inhabiting a particular country or territory. It's cultural. If people have a lot in common, for example, we talk about the Indian culture, so India becomes a nation. When we talk about India as a country, we talk about it as a state. And the third concept used in the essay, a plural society, is a society composed of different ethnic groups or cultural traditions, or in the political structure of which ethnic or cultural differences are reflected. Not only ethnic, it could be any groups. It could be caste groups, it could be religious groups, it could be any groups. I have taken the narrow definition dictionary meaning, but as I have said, it goes far, far beyond. A plural society has everything. It can have multiple religions, multiple ethnicities, multiple languages, multiple caste creeds, and so on and so forth. Now, having understood the meanings, we are talking about South Asia, South Asian identities. Now, what is South Asia? South Asia, going strictly by the current definition, it includes the countries of Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Pakistan, Nepal, and Sri Lanka, and also includes Afghanistan and Maldives, essentially SAARC. I repeat, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Pakistan, Nepal, Sri Lanka, meaning India and its immediate neighbors, and Afghanistan and Maldives. The term is also used synonymously with the Indian subcontinent. Now, that is a very, very meaningful concept, because a subcontinent means it has multiple plural identities. The society is not homogeneous. It's practically a continent with all kinds of people, all kinds of cultures intermixing. Having done that, let me come to the introduction part of my essay. I'll start with these very short definitions. I'll quickly define a state, a nation, a plural identity, and South Asia, and specifically the idea of a subcontinent, because the idea of the subcontinent actually defines this essay. There are so many identities, just like a continent. Historically, a common yet plural culture. Many of us have a common descent. We were all one historically before the political boundaries got created. Because the area is so vast, local cultures, subcultures developed. And there was an undercurrent of unity in this huge diversity. The idea of the state, or of political disunity or unity, as you might look at it, was superimposed much, much, much later, as you'll see here. In para 1, I would say that though the cultural identities are ancient, the state is new. I've already said it. I will elaborate in my para 1. I will give examples. Now, if you look at the countries in the modern sense as they exist today, Afghanistan 1919, Bangladesh 1971, Bhutan 1907, India 1947, Maldives 65, Myanmar 48, Nepal 1923, Pakistan 1947, Sri Lanka 1948. All of them from the 20th century, yet the cultures are go way, way back. They are very, very ancient. Now, when we talk about the identities, our plural identities, they can be linguistic, multiple linguistic groups in this region. They can be ethnic, very obviously, starting from the Aryan and the Dravidian and so on and so forth. Religious, almost every religion on earth is represented in this region. Caste is a peculiar feature of this region. Essentially starting as a Vedic Hindu concept. Now it cuts across religions. Many identities cut across state borders. For example, Bangladesh is an Islamic country, but essentially a Bengali country, has a lot in common with West Bengal and India. The Punjab part of Pakistan, the Punjab part of India have a huge commonality of culture. The Tamils in Tamil Nadu and the Tamils in Sri Lanka, a lot of common features. Similarly, religions. Now, Nepal is a Hindu country. Myanmar is predominantly a Buddhist country. Bhutan is a purely Buddhist country and so on and so forth. And yet these religions have cut across the entire region. Islam, for example. And of course, historical and mythological texts talk about these commonalities, talk about these plural cultures, the idea of the Jambudvip, the idea of the Aryavrata and so on and so forth. Meaning, I am trying to reinforce in para 1 what I have said earlier in the introduction, that huge amount of cultural identities are here, plural identities. The superimposition of the state is a much later 20th century concept. I'll move to para 2. Very, very obviously, we have shared historical experiences. Many of these countries were colonial areas once upon a time. Because the cultures are common, the historical experiences, apart from the colonial part, are also common. Subcultures cross-connect. As I've already mentioned earlier, that the cultures of Bangladesh and Bengal, for example, the various languages intermingling to create something new. Food, for example, the huge cross-connect of subcultures. And you can give an example here. It could be your example, it could be anybody else's example, it could be a societal example. I've given my own example here, that I'm an Indian, I'm a Hindu, I'm a Punjabi, I belong to Uttar Pradesh, I'm married to a Malayali, I speak Bengali, I have friends across national other identities, and I am from an All India Service. I also have a caste identity for that matter. Now, with so many identities, and all these identities go before the idea of a state in the political context. Now, if you look, there are so many subcultures that I am part of, so many subcultures I connect to. And if I do that with so many plural identities, plural cultures have to go hand in hand. I'm comfortable with almost all the subcultures that I'm part of. And despite some divisiveness, very, very obviously, this idea of plurality rules in South Asia. We are divided. I would strongly write in my essay that the divisiveness is political. The cultural identities are common, and they are something that we genuinely subconsciously believe in. Moving to para 3, I would give one two examples of religions. As I've said earlier, I'll elaborate that many religions were born here: Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism. Many others have come from outside and assimilated them into the Indian culture. Now, for example, I'll take the example of Kerala here. Now, Kerala has a very large population of Hindus, Muslims, and Christians. And yet they have a very strong common identity of being from Kerala or being Malayalis. The assimilation is not only of religions, the assimilation is also regional, the assimilation is also of language. And many subcultures were born out of these predominant cultures. The Malayali culture can, for example, can be subdivided into so many, as I've said earlier. The culture of Uttar Pradesh, the culture of, you take any part of the country, that there'll be many subcultures, localized cultures, with the predominant culture remaining broadly the same. Taking the example of languages, Sanskrit is the mother of almost every modern language. Languages have assimilated, Urdu is a classic example. Languages cut across borders, as I've said, Punjabi, Bengali, Tamil. And there has been an almost constant churning of cultures throughout history. We have had foreign invaders, we have had foreign travelers, people have gone out from this country, people have come into this country, people have settled down into this country, starting from the so-called entry of the Aryans into India, then the Greeks, they became the Indo-Greeks, the Parthians, the Muslims, finally the Christians, people coming in and out, with a constant churning of cultures, as I've said. And these, as again, go back a long, long back to ancient India. Remember, Alexander came at a time when the ideas of even regions was not there. Forget about nations. Coming to the paragraph 4, I would try to sort of bring everything into one place, what I've said earlier, that the state has superimposed itself on plural cultures and identities and created a new identity, the national identity. The national identity, as I pointed out earlier, has come much later. Most of the countries of this region, every country of this region was born in the 20th century, in the modern sense. And sadly, in spite of this commonality and, you know, so many plural cultures going hand in hand, the state, unfortunately, across this region has acted as a divisive force rather than a unifying one. In a cultural mix, the melting pot of cultures with so many identities, the concept of political boundaries has very, very limited use. It defines countries as political units. It defines the idea of who belongs where. It has created the national identity, but barring that, political boundaries actually, to my mind, are meaningless. And of course, the concept of state in the modern sense is a Western construct. Almost every country which became a country in the 20th century here had the British creating these boundaries. And if you compare the state in South Asia with the Western state, there is a huge, huge difference. The Western countries or the Western states are homogeneous. I mean, if you ignore the migration that has been happening in the recent past, they are very, very homogeneous states. The idea of the state might fit into a homogeneous society like the Western world. It does not, beyond a point, fit into a society like the South Asian society. Definitely, though, it has created an identity, national identity. And I would finally conclude by saying that cultural pluralism is a pattern or a system in which people of different faiths, religions, castes, creeds can all work and live together, retaining proudly their own faith and identity and sharing the common bond of being either by birth or by choice. Plural culture means the coexistence of several subcultures within a given society on equal terms. In such a pluralistic culture, the validity of various subcultures is recognized. This actually sums up exactly what I've been saying throughout my essay. This essay is finally about unity and diversity. That is what this paragraph is saying. I would say that the plural cultures existing together in peace for centuries is the beautiful idea of unity and diversity, because South Asia is so diverse and yet has an undercurrent of unity. That is why it is different from the rest of the world. And I would end by saying that finally a synthesis of the state and plural culture identities has emerged, with both complementing each other. The essay is about, now before I end, the essay is about identities, the original identities that we have, multiple identities as I've given in my own example. And if we have multiple identities, we have multiple cultures cutting across each other, and we have learned to be comfortable with all of them. And remember, this essay is about society in paper one. Thank you so much, and as usual, kindly attempt the practice essays given by IS Baba here, one about the National Register of Citizens and the second about abrogation of Article 370. Thank you once again.